This is our last session. Ludmilla, don't go away. This is our last session of the Spring Blog Festival. And it's been amazing, amazing 3 days. And Adam, you're here, thank goodness. I was looking for you on Skype. Okay, and we're going to have a special treat. So get your friends to come over. And thank you, Ludmilla, for offering to help out. I am going to need you because I'm going to be going back and forth. I've got some challenges here at home, okay, not issues or problems. Adam has been working hard on his presentation here, and it's really amazing. There's Adam over there, okay, right here. He is our last presenter. We've had amazing presentations, and it's been so inspiring. And don't go away, Ludmilla. And so wonderful to have everybody, and I'm looking forward to getting your feedback, of course. The presenters will get certificates, and the participants will also get a certificate for doing and reflecting through blogging. So Adam, I'm going to pass on the link to you. I see that you're not in with your co-presenter link for some reason. I don't know what happened there. Sorry, I wasn't available on Skype. Adam, are you able to?
Yes.
Oh, great. Wonderful.
Can you hear me?
Yes. Yes, we can. So I'm going to let you start because I know you've got a lot to say, and we want to hear everything. So if you have to go over time, that's okay, because you know you're the last one, so we're going to keep an eye on the time to make sure that we extend. In fact, you know what? Let me do that right now. Let me extend the class so that we have enough time. Okay, so I think 8 hours should be enough, right? No, I'm just kidding.
8 hours. I think that's.
We'll have to do it one day. Okay, so I'll give you the floor and I'll just take off everything. Thank you for joining us, everybody, and thank you to Adam.
Thank you, Nellie. Thank you for the fabulous introduction. I'd like to welcome everybody to this webinar. And today we're going to be talking about visual thinking, and I call it the revolution, or say the evolution of learning, and how we can apply that into schools. And I'm going to talk about students, but when I talk students, I'm talking about you, who's a lifelong learner moving forward. So a lot of this information sort of applies all around. As we move forward, I wanted to just highlight one thing. I wanted to highlight this little pencil here. And taking mine out, I want to encourage you to draw, to take one of these out, and to draw and to doodle and to just focus. There'll be specific things that I will ask you to do throughout the webinar. But even throughout the process, if you feel inspired, please take it out and start to doodle. Just start to do some things, and I think you'll find that it's a new way of sort of thinking, and I hope that the webinar will sort of show that as we go through it. So let's move on. Let's get started. I want to just give you a little background about my journey. So it started off in high school for me. Well, not much really happened in high school. I was kind of like an average student, not much really going on, but I was really curious. I had this curiosity to want to learn. I wanted to know what was it that separated those smart kids from everybody else. I mean, I was working just as hard as they were, and if not harder, and unfortunately I wasn't getting the results that they were getting. But I didn't really quite get that in high school. I didn't quite get that answer. It wasn't until at university when I came across Tony Buzan. I was at the university library, and I came across Tony Buzan's mind map book. So there he is. There's Tony right here. And that's his mind map book. And so I came across his book, and it kind of changed the way I was doing things. It changed the way I was thinking about a lot of different things. in my life and with my studies. What happened is at university before, I used to just take notes, just kind of, you know, notes on lined paper. But now, since I was introduced to Tony Buzan's book, I was there at university, sitting inside a lecture, taking out A3 sheets of paper. These are A4, but I was taking A3 sheets of paper, putting them in front of me and drawing mind maps. And there was other students that were just sitting back, you know, around my shoulder thinking, what is he doing? This is crazy. I can't believe he can learn using this sort of method, because not a lot of them knew about mind mapping at the time. So, but eventually some of them understood how the process worked, and some of them even kept mind mapping themselves. So I used that process of mind mapping to help me through my university studies, and that helped me boost my grades and helped me develop the memory and recall of the information I was learning. I was always passionate about self-improvement and self-growth and that, and that's why a couple of years after university, I attained my life coaching qualifications, and I became a life coach. And I kind of took the next step of my journey was kind of taking that life coaching and mind mapping, kind of putting them together, and launching IQMatrix.com. So that was launched in 2008, and it's now got over 250 self-growth mind maps. And you'll find these mind maps on the next slide. There you go. That's like one of the mind maps that I just released just recently. And there's 250 mind maps that cover topics: career, emotions, academics, achievement, creative thinking, problem solving, psychology, life coaching, health, wealth, and much more. And there's a gallery of maps where you can just view all the maps. If you're not familiar with them, go to gallery.iqmatrix.com. But overall, for this webinar, my focus isn't going to be so much on IQ Matrix, but it's going to be like the next step of how I'm kind of moving from IQ into more visual thinking kind of tools and processes and that. So let's go through, I want to go through the goals for our session today. So what I would like to do is I want to identify the gaps and opportunities for evolution, for visual thinking evolution within the current education system. I want to introduce you to the process of visual thinking. I want to break down any resistance you might have to doodling. I want to explore the benefits of IQ doodling versus standard forms of note taking, and I'll explain that process a little bit later. I want to explore the process of using mind maps for self-growth and personal transformation. I want to show you how to summarize content using mind maps and present several visual thinking self-growth activities you can use to help empower students or help empower yourself. So like I mentioned before, this is for you as it is for students. Anyone who's learning, who's overcoming problems and anything, this is for you. So that's that whole process. And as we move through this process, I think you will find that every step we go along through this webinar, it goes on to the next, next, to the next. And I hope that you'll find it of value and that everything sort of comes together right at the end. So this is our visual agenda, and we're going to begin with discussing what is a doodle, and I'm sure many of you are familiar what a doodle is. I'm going to ask you what kind of doodler you are. Then we're going to move to IQ doodles and explain that process and show you how it kind of involves a whole brain. And then we're going to launch into three specific things. We're going to look at doodle studies, the proof that doodling actually works and that the visual thinking is actually the key to learning, to expanding your potential as a student, as a human being. We're going to look at the visual void within the education system. We're going to take you through a historical voyage of visual thinking just quickly there as well. I'm going to introduce you to the visual alphabet and to how to doodle. We're going to draw pictures. This is where I would need to take out one of these, a pencil and some paper, and just start trying a few things out. I'm not going to be there to see your doodle, so I'm not going to be judging or anything like that. So feel free to just scribble all over your pieces of paper. And we're going to go into visual note-taking, mind mapping, and compare them. I'm going to show you some practical examples of how I create IQ doodles using information. Then we're going to launch into an IQ matrix example. So I'm not going to focus a lot on that, but we'll kind of touch on that a little bit, because I think the map there is quite relevant to what we're doing here today. And then everything comes together when we launch into visual thinking, self-growth activities. So that's our visual agenda for today. Okay. Now, so the definition of a doodle is a rough drawing made absent-mindedly. And to be absent-minded is to show inattentive or forgetful behavior. Now, that can't be a good thing if we're forgetting things, right? So, but in actuality, it is good because doodling helps keep your mind focused and centered and mindful of the present moment. So when you're actually doodling, as long as your mind is focused in the right way, it helps you to tune in to what you are doing. So this is not what a real doodle is about, but more about that shortly, especially when I get into the doodle studies, and I'll show you how this process sort of works. So what kind of doodle are you? And I would like you to share your comments in this and identify what kind of doodler you are. Are you this guy? Are you the happy doodler? Are you absolutely love to doodle? So you're the first. You're going to take out a pen. You're going to be the first in class or in a lecture or whatever it is, and you're going to get your pen out and you're going to be doodling. Or maybe you're this guy. It's interesting, but I'm not sure. Maybe I'll give it a try. Or maybe you're this guy. It's like, oh no, I can't doodle. This is my worst nightmare. I mean, I'm not from a family of doodlers, so I can't doodle. So feel free to share which kind of doodler you are and let me know throughout this whole process. And I hope that by the end of this process, all of us can become like this first guy here. And it's okay if you can't doodle, because I'm going to show you a nice and easy process how to actually doodle, and it doesn't take any skill whatsoever. Okay, so what is an IQ doodle? An IQ doodle is a process of turning your thoughts and ideas into structured visual notes, symbols, and words on paper. This helps improve your memory and the recall of the information you are listening to and learning. And the key to an IQ doodle is it involves the brain, it involves the body. They both work together. And while you're doodling, your mind and body work together, and as a result, you are able to recall and remember more of what you are learning. But call it an IQ doodle, but there are also other names for this process. There's visual note-taking, there's sketch-noting, and there's info-doodling. Sketch-noting is a very popular term. I call it IQ doodle because it kind of intertwines with IQ matrix, and I think that it's an intelligent sort of form of doodling, an intelligent sort of structured form of doodling. So IQ doodles engage the whole brain. So when your brain is working with both words and pictures at the same time, it's more engaged with what you are doing, and you are therefore more likely to remember and retain this information long term. Now, if we look at this graphic here, this is a very interesting graphic because it shows how the brain processes information. Now, as you see here, 75% of the brain is actually hardwired to think visually, and only 25% of the brain is hardwired to think through the other senses. So that's quite surprising, because some people will tell me, oh, I'm not a visual thinker. I'm more of an auditory type of thinker or kinesthetic type of thinker. But then I'll say, well, the brain's processing power, it's all hardwired to think visually. 75% of it is actually hardwired to think visually. You're probably just not applying yourself. You're not learning in the right sort of way. And then I hope that I can introduce them to visual thinking processes that will help them to learn the information much more effectively through a visual means. So 75% of neurons in your brain process sensory information. So that's 3/4 of your brain dedicated to vision. What does this say about our visual processing power? So this is the brain. This is our brain, and we've got the left and we've got the right hemispheres of the brain. So we've got the left side, which is the logical side. So we've got words, logic, numbers, lists. Then we've got the right side, which is the creative side of the brain, rhythm, imagination, color, and daydreaming. The brain is conditioned to kind of craves and excitement and color. It remembers best in pictures because it's hardwired to think visually. But the fact is that most of the learning that we do in schools, especially in schools, we use the left side of the brain, predominantly the left side of the brain. And as a result, what happens? We're basically teaching kids. We're telling them, here, learn this piece of information. Here you go. And I want you to learn it in this way, but I only want you to use half your brain. I mean, if we told kids that way, what would they think? They would think, okay, I'm using only half a brain to learn this, so what's the point? Why can't I use my whole brain? Why can't I use more of my right side of my brain? And that's what we want to encourage students and learners to do, to use their whole brain when they're taking notes. So I want to ask you, which side of the brain do you predominantly use when you take notes or when you're learning? And I think that sometimes we forget that the right side can really help us in a lot of different ways. But I'll tell you more about that shortly. So IQ doodling simplifies concepts. When you're IQ doodling, it makes it easy to present complex ideas in a simplified way using words, pictures, diagrams, and charts, graphs and charts. So it's not about just pictures, not about just doodling little things like this. It's all about the combination of a variety of different elements that come together into an IQ doodle that kind of creates this sort of thing that helps us to remember information, helps us learn more effectively. And I'll get into that a little bit later, more detail into that. So IQ doodling allows you to present complex ideas quickly, easily, effectively. It also helps focus on the most important points. This is what I call a void. It's not somewhere in space, not somewhere in outer space. It's actually somewhere within the education system, the current education system. So it's the big visual void, I call this. Now, this is the gap within the education system where visual thinking can sort of fit into it. And I hope that as we move through this webinar, you'll see that there is a place for whatever it is that I'm going to be moving through and discussing, that we can actually have that in the current education system and can help students really develop and evolve and get them through a new age of innovation. So the current education system is focused primarily on reading, writing, and arithmetic. Now, that's all well and good, very important things, but given the fact that, remember, we process 75% of the brain is dedicated to processing of information. We normally focus on the other and maybe a little bit on the visual side. So basically, no wonder kids are feeling like this. Kids are simply unable to access the full potential of their brain. We're encouraging them to use just one side, primarily one side of the brain, so they're not able to use the whole brain. And as a result, they struggle. They struggle in school. So what are the consequences? Well, they have difficulty concentrating. Because they're not using both sides of the brain, they can't concentrate. And as a result, they're bored. They struggle. They're bored. And then they have more difficulty concentrating because they're bored. We are not stimulating them because there's a lack of creativity within the information that we're teaching kids. And there's a lack of creativity because we do not encourage imagination. And imagination should be encouraged in everything that we do. And that obviously leads to thinking habits. So lack of creativity, little imagination, and poor thinking habits. And as a result, poor memory and recall. And that results in ineffective learning. So as a result, it leads to ineffective learning. And kids really must come to understand that visual language and expressing themselves visually is a natural part of being human. Understanding how to use these visual skills opens doors to a world of incredible opportunity. So we must be able to really address these areas. And it all starts, I think, with imagination, with encouraging imagination in a lot of different ways. So kids will gain a superior advantage when they eventually enter the workforce if they are taught how to develop their ability to think creatively and solve problems using visual language skills. Here's what I believe. I believe the school system must provide a platform that prepares kids for the real world. And this includes, first of all, strengthening their imagination. So we first work on strengthening a child's imagination. So I'm talking about children in primary school, I'm talking about high school kids, and I'm talking about you. I'm talking about you if you're working through adversity, trying to overcome problems. So strengthen imagination, that will encourage creativity. And then work on critical thinking skills. Critical thinking, creativity work hand in hand. Once all these three elements are pieced together, then you will be able to, and kids will be able to cope with their emotions much more effectively. And as a result, they'll be able to handle conflict. And therefore, they'll be able to handle and overcome adversity much more effectively as well. And in order to improve how they handle adversity, they'll help to strengthen the imagination. And again, they move through this circle. But when it comes to overcoming adversity, we need to focus on teaching kids three fundamental things: hindsight, insight, and foresight. They are the keys to making better decisions. And when we are able to make better decisions, we are able to solve everyday problems. And kids are able to solve everyday problems. And therefore, following this process, we are able to introduce kids and prepare them for real-world problems. And I think the education system is really lacking in that regard. So it all becomes possible when we combine the doodle, self-growth, and visual thinking tools. And that's what this webinar is sort of about, kind of mixing these tools together. And if you stay tuned in to the very end, that's where you'll see everything sort of come together into one, where we mix these items together. So visual thinking provides a platform where all this becomes possible because it helps bring thoughts to life, thereby allowing kids to develop necessary hindsight, insight, and foresight required to make smarter, better, and more creative decisions about everyday problems. So preparing kids for the age of innovation. This is an iPad, as you can see, and this is a map by Paul Foreman, my friend Paul Foreman. And he's created a whole, about hundreds, literally hundreds of personal development mind maps. So he's all hand-drawn. So check out his website, mindmapinspiration.com. And I wanted to use this map here because we are entering the age of innovation. I think we're already there. Before, in the early 2000s, we were in the age of information. And in the age of information, it was like, get as much information out there, learn as much information. Now there's so much information, you need to be able to stand out. So you need to be able to innovate. And that's what kids need to be able to do. They need to be able to innovate in a lot of different ways moving forward. So as a result, we are in a new technological world built upon ideas, visuals, creativity, and imagination. And that's what we must encourage kids to focus on. So here is some proof. Now this is the really cool part, I think, because here's proof that doodling actually works. We're going to look at three specific studies. We're going to look at the listening doodle, we're going to look at the science doodle, and we're going to look at the funky font. So they're all important studies. And I've provided references here. I don't think you'll be able to click on these references, but these PowerPoint slides will be made available at a later time, and you'll be able to click through on these references and visit the articles that explain what these studies are about for more information. So let's go through the first study, the listening doodle. Now, this is Jackie Andrade. So Jackie Andrade is a psychologist. She's from England. She conducted a study, and this is her study, and let's go through it now. I think she conducted a study at Plymouth University. I mean, she's from Plymouth University. For those who are in England, I'm not sure if I said that correctly, Plymouth, I think so. Well, she took two groups of 20 individuals. So she had a control group and she had an experimental group. Now, within these two groups, she asked them to listen to a voicemail message for two and a half minutes. Now, this voicemail message was about someone just leaving a voicemail message about invitation to a party. So it was like very boring, sort of monotone sort of message. Now, mind you, this was a study conducted after another initial study that she actually had. So they weren't expecting the study was coming. So they both groups listened to that voicemail message for 2.5 minutes. The difference was that the experimental group was asked to shade in little squares and boxes. So shade in little squares and boxes while they were listening to the voicemail message. And at the end of once they listened to the voicemail message, both groups were giving a surprise, a pop quiz. Oh no, I wasn't expecting a pop quiz, okay? A surprise quiz. So now they had to actually answer questions of what they heard within the voicemail message. Now, the interesting thing was that Jackie found that when she tested both groups, that the experimental group remembered 29% more information, 29% more information than the control group. And she factored that to the fact that they were actually shading circles and squares while they were listening to the voicemail message. So remember how we spoke about that when you're doodling, you're actually more mindful of the present moment. And this is what this study proves, that when you doodle, you're more mindful of the present moment. And I know they weren't really doing much except for coloring, but it's the process of actually doing something with your hand and involving your mind that really helps you focus in on those important areas. And I think the other students, or the other kind of control group, they were more busy thinking about what they had for dinner, what they're going to eat for dinner, what they're going to do tomorrow. So they weren't really focused on that voicemail message. Then we've got the science doodle study. So three researchers, Vaughan Prang, Sharon Ainsworth, and Russell Titler. And they conducted a study. So this is their research paper in 2011, Boring to Learn in Science. Now, they went to schools and they went to science students and to science classes, and they wanted to encourage students in order to, instead of learning the regular type of way that they would learn science, the science subject, by taking notes and everything, they wanted to encourage them to doodle, to visualize everything that they were actually learning. So they took that information, whatever they were learning, and they visualized it. And here are some results. So these are some of the visuals that they created. They created these visuals here. And as a result, this is what happened. So they conducted it for a specific amount of time. And the researchers found that after they spent time visualizing all these different subject materials, and instead of writing out notes like they regularly would, they accelerated learning, they had a deeper learning experience. They improved reasoning, they had better retention, and they had more enjoyment, and they were more engaged in what they were doing. It was just a remarkable sort of experience that the researchers, like remarkable findings, that it actually improved learning. And as a result, they concluded that drawing is great, but it should complement other activities such as writing and talking, not replace them. They also conclude that drawing also enhances creativity. So it's not so much about, I'm not going to tell you just doodle everything, draw pictures about absolutely everything. No, this is all about mixing different forms of learning together in a visual way that helps you to remember this information much more effectively. So read, write, talk, and draw. That's the conclusion from the study. Read, write, talk, and draw. Use those processes in order to learn information as effectively as you possibly can. So let's jump on to the third study, the funky font study. So Demon Yaoman, who's a researcher, and his research team, he wanted to conduct a study. So remember back in high school, back in university, that we all received like handouts, not blank handouts, I guess, but we all received kind of class notes. And the class notes have the kind of easy to read types of fonts, right? So what he wanted to do was he thought about it and he's thinking, okay, well, how about we change the fonts and make them like really difficult to read? I mean, could that actually help improve a student's learning ability? And so he conducted a study. So he said, okay, well, let's go. Let's recruit all these teachers. So he said, teachers, come and join us. So recruit all these teachers from English, physics, chemistry and history. And he asked them to send us your class notes. So send us your class notes via regular mail, via email. So send them off to us and we'll put them through a funky font machine. So they'll put them through a funky font machine. Not really. I just thought that was a little clever thing to actually put there. I think they actually probably just redid them on the computer, but let's just pretend it was a funky font machine. And what happened is they changed these fonts, the regular types of fonts that we used within the class notes, and they changed them to monotype Corsiva, Comic Sans, and Hattenschweiler. I have no idea if I said that correctly. I hope so. Okay, so these three fonts were just added to the class notes. So the class are now in these three types of fonts. They resent the notes back by a bird carrier. Not really bird carrier, but they sent them back to the classes, to the teachers, and they handed it out to their students. So 222 students were involved. And as a result, I think it would took about 1.5 weeks to a month. Different classes were involved for different periods of time. So some students received the regular notes and other students received the funky font notes. And what they found was, what they discovered was that students reviewing class notes using funky fonts performed better when tested. It elevated their attention and the retention of information. So, I mean, that is quite remarkable. Just to think about it, that fonts, the act of just changing the fonts improved the student's learning ability. I guess it just goes to show, I guess the way they sort of pointed it out is that when things are a little bit more difficult, a little bit more unusual than normal, our brain is more engaged. And when our brain is more engaged, it helps us to really learn and capture that information much more effectively. So that's the main idea that this study is getting across. I want to introduce you to Professor Richard Mayer, author of Multimedia Learning. Now, Professor, that's his Multimedia Learning. You can have a look at that book on Amazon. Second edition, he's also got a first edition that you might be able to pick up as well. So he concluded that he's done a lot of research in this area about multimedia learning, about different types of kind of learning. He concluded that after ample research, I have concluded that retention and recall are boosted 42% with multimedia learning and a whopping 9% with illustrated text. So after research, he's actually concluded, after ample research, retention and recall are boosted 89% with illustrated text. So I hope that everyone, you guys can see how important it is to start encouraging visual thinking, to start moving forward in this area. So let's quickly have a look at visual thinking through time. Now, we're all aware of ancient pictographs or cave wall doodles. We've seen images of these everywhere. I've seen documentaries. And these are early forms of visual thinking that we, our ancestors, sort of put together to explain, to express themselves, to explain what words couldn't express because they didn't have a language at the time. So this was their language. Let me move a little bit forward in time. We've got Egyptian hieroglyphics. And as you can see, each Egyptian hieroglyphic has a meaning. There's a meaning behind everything. So this was their language. This was their kind of written visual sort of language. Then further forward, we have Leonardo da Vinci and Charles Darwin. Now, Leonardo da Vinci is probably one of my greatest inspirations. I'm not sure if anyone knows about his life or much about his life. He actually used to, he kept a notebook with him everywhere he went. He would just draw ideas. He would observe. He was curious. He was insatiably curious about absolutely everything. He would take his notebook everywhere with him and he would just draw or look, question the world, question people's emotions, people's reactions, question how things work and everything. And he would just get his thoughts down on paper as much as possible. And as a result, he came up with ingenious ideas, ingenious inventions that we marvel at. Now, the question is, did he become a genius? Was he born a genius, or did he become a genius just because he was actually curious and drew things on paper, wanted to ask questions, drew things on paper? I guess that's the one thing that we need to ask ourselves. Is it born genius, or is it because we have so much curiosity and we visualize what we're trying to do, what we visualize our world on paper, and that's what helps us to become genius, so to speak? Charles Darwin, I wanted to produce, give this example of Charles Darwin, and this might be the very first mind map ever created. Now, Charles Darwin was obviously a great thinker as well, and this is, I guess, his evolutionary tree, so to speak. But how a lot of scientific minds, a lot of scientific thinkers have thought about things in the past and how they kind of visualized what they were doing. And this brings me to two other scientific thinkers. So we've got Isaac Newton and Thomas Edison. Now, they visualized their scientific experiments. And you might be thinking, well, they're scientists. Adam, they are scientists. They have to visualize things. But what is science really? Isn't science the act of solving problems? There's a problem, we need to solve it. So we solved that problem, and what these scientists did is they actually took that problem, they visualized it, and then they brought about a solution through their visual language and, you know, through their visuals, and they ended up, you know, solving that problem. And same thing with our life. Okay, we have problems as well. Could it not help to visualize our problems as well to help us to overcome those problems? Maybe. Maybe, and we'll get into that a little bit towards the end of this presentation. And then we have symbols. We use symbols in science, mathematics, music, and these are the modern day symbols that sort of transcend cultural boundaries. So as you can see, I mean, I guess visual information, visual language is, you can communicate with someone who doesn't understand much language in a visual way. And I guess that's another benefit of visual language, so to speak. This is a filmmaking storyboard from a Disney movie. If you can tell me what Disney movie this is, then I'll love to know. I'm not sure if this movie was even released. But it just goes to show, we're going to touch on storyboarding a little bit later and how it can be used to solve problems. So I wanted to share this, that pictures and visuals are used in a variety of ways to sort of present a path forward. And if you just imagine this without the visuals, and just the words, it would be a whole very different experience. So examples of visual language are all around us, and the impact it has on our lives is absolutely profound. In fact, human advancement probably would not have been possible without the use of visual language of some sort that has helped ordinary people imagine extraordinary results, extraordinary things, and thereby change the course of history forever. So the question is, why can't we all do these extraordinary things? And, well, we absolutely can. And it all begins with a simple doodle. So that this kind of launches us into the next step of our journey. What is a doodle, really? I've created this mind map using a mind manager just to kind of show you the different requirements of what it takes to be a doodler, to be able to think visually, so to speak. I want to first point out this red branch, that doodling doesn't require hand-eye coordination, because it's not about artwork. It's not about you creating marvelous artwork like Leonardo da Vinci, who had ample practice, you know, in creating all these visuals. It's all about ideas. In the green branch, it's all about ideas, not artwork. But what doodling does require from us is it requires us to transform things into its simplest form. So we're trying to transform things, make them simpler by doodling them out. It requires us to become perceptive of people, of objects, of your environment, of your surroundings, as Leonardo da Vinci did. It requires us to be curious, and by asking questions such as, how does this work? How does this interact with that? How could I break this down into its basic shape? So it's all a curiosity when it comes to visual thinking. And it requires an ability to recognize shapes, lines, angles, shadows, colors, patterns, ability to make connections, associations, to imagine unique ways of presenting things, and to bring thoughts to life. And we'll touch on that shortly. It requires creative self-expression to give doodles structure and purpose. So they're the requirements. If you want to become a visual thinker, you must be able to and willing to touch upon all these different elements. So bringing thoughts to life. So when we bring thoughts to life, we're taking things out of our head, out of our imagination, and putting them down on paper. And that's the most incredible thing that we can really do, because normally the normal way we would learn is we would have structured notes, we have them in front of us, and we're trying to take that information, we're trying to bring it into our heads, into our imagination. But when we actually bring thoughts to life through visual thinking, we're actually taking our imagination, we're combining it with the information we have before us, and we're creating something new, something different. And when you take things out of your imagination and bring them to life like that, you can explore that information much more effectively. You can evaluate it. You can expand on it. You can modify it. You can reimagine it in endless ways. And that's what we're trying to do through this whole process. So let's look at the visual alphabet. This is really where I would like you to take out one of these, a pencil, take out a sheet of paper, and just doodle with me. These things don't take long to doodle, but just try them, just to get a feel for things. Now, this visual alphabet is attributed to Dave Gray. That's when I first came across his visual alphabet. And he's one of the early pioneers of the visual thinking sort of movement in this day and age. Now, he introduced 10 different sort of steps. So we've got the oval, the eye, the triangle, the rectangle, the house, and the blob. Now, I would like to ask you, are you able to draw these shapes? Can you draw these shapes? Are they easy? Are they difficult to draw? These are basic shapes that I assume just about everybody, I assume pretty much everybody should be able to draw. And then there are the second step. Okay, great. Yes, I can. Fantastic. Thank you. That's great to hear. I mean, if you can draw these shapes, these 10 shapes, these are open shapes and these are closed shapes, then I'm going to test you right now. I'm not going to see, but I'm going to test you just to see how good you are drawing simple objects using these shapes. Because I guarantee you that you can draw pretty much just about anything you want using a combination of these shapes. So let's try that out right now. Using the visual alphabet. Okay, I want you to pick one or two of these words or these things and just draw them out on paper. Simplest way possible using those visual alphabet we spoke about before. So computer, pan, car, house, cup, telephone, pot plants, ball, book, lamp. So draw them right now. I'll give you a few seconds to draw them. Draw one or two objects, that's it. That's all you need to draw. Okay, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. All right, here are my drawings of these objects. Are they complex? Are they artistic? Are they, you know, is it like Leonardo da Vinci? No, of course not. But the key is, do they get across the right sort of idea? Can you tell that this is a house? Can you tell that this is a car? Can you tell that this is a book? Yeah, easy. And all I've used is elements of that visual alphabet in order to combine these things. So that's a donut. Kind of looks like a donut. That probably kind of looks like a pan, but maybe it kind of looks like a tennis racket or kind of like a magnifying glass as well. So if in doubt, label it. If in doubt, label it, definitely. So let's go through another one. Let's go another one. Again, I'll give you a few seconds. Pick one or two of these and draw it. Pencil, factory, earth, cat, clock, robot, balloon, dog, boat, tree, light bulb, truck. So again, focus on simple shapes. Simple. It's not about artwork. It's about getting these ideas across. Here we go. Here are my visuals of this. So we've got the pencil, we've got the factory, we've got earth, we've got the boats, a robot, and you can probably draw robots numerous ways. And yeah, very easy again. Very easy shapes, kind of putting things together. So that's that. And I think I wanted to, I guess, encourage you to, if you're going to become a visual thinker, to develop your visual vocabulary. So take all these different things. So draw a tree. I'm going to draw a tree like this every single time. I'm going to draw a cat like this every single time. I'm going to draw a book like this every single time. So create your own visual vocabulary so you can draw these things very easily and simply as you move forward and expand and explore your visual thinking skills. So how about drawing people? Now you might be thinking, oh, Adam, okay, drawing those things is okay, but people, come on, people are hard. I mean, look at us, look at these wonky hands we have, you know, we've got these head and everything like that. Come on, it's a little bit more complex drawing people. Well, maybe not so complex. How about stick people? Can you draw a stick person? Can you draw a block person? Can you draw a blob person? Can you draw star people? Triangle people? Can you use your imagination? Because it doesn't really matter. Because the idea is that this is a person, this is a person. You can tell that this is a person, can you not? It's easy to sort of tell that this is a person. And that's the idea that I'm trying to get across. I'm not trying to be artistic or anything. I'm saying this is a person. And that's what we want to do. That's what we want to do, just express ideas effectively. Okay, well, how about drawing active people? I mean, that's another step forward, I guess. It's kind of a little bit more tricky. We have to kind of imagine how people kind of look in different sort of poses when they're walking, when they're kind of bending over, when they're doing all sorts of things. But if we stick to simple stick figures, then I think it shouldn't be too difficult. Let's have a look. So, person walking, and feel free to pick up one of these and draw this with me, because you won't know that you can draw them until you try. So we have a person walking, then we have a person running. As you can see, the posture is a little bit different. He's kind of leaning forward. Kind of imagine yourself kind of running. What kind of posture would you have? Person walking. You have a person jumping. Person jumping, you have the lines sort of indicated the jumping and then the ground on the bottom. Then we have a person sitting on an invisible chair. The chair is there, otherwise he would have fallen over. So trust me, the chair is there. It's invisible, but it is there. Or maybe not. Maybe someone pulled the chair under him and is now fallen over. Oops. And this guy has sort of tripped over the invisible chair. Okay, so maybe we should take the invisible chair out of the picture. Okay, let's go another one. Splat. Okay, a person splatting on the ground. A person skipping. So we've got skipping, see the posture, and skipping. The horizontal line anchors the figure to the ground. That's always important to remember. And we've got a person crouching, a person doing a handstand, a person crawling, looking for contact lenses, and a person meditating. We've got a person, does it kind of look like meditating? Yes, sort of, maybe. If not, if in doubt, label it. Then we've got another one, a person resting, a person praying, a person doing the splits, very confident looking person doing the splits, a person reaching down, a person thinking, and a person spinning. And if that doesn't look like a person spinning, then you know it's spinning because I've written underneath that it's spinning. So it's a combination of words and pictures that kind of puts everything into context, sort of puts it all together. So then we have drawing facial expressions. So the next step, I guess, for us is, because we're involved, we're human, and we're probably going to be drawing a lot of humans, a lot of people, and facial expressions are just one of the things that I guess we'll sort of need to end up drawing. But facial expression, might be thinking, oh, I mean, Adam, come on, humans, stick figures, that's fine, but facial expression, I mean, we've got all this stuff going on here, I mean, come on, I mean, that will be difficult to draw, right? Well, not so much. There is something I want to introduce you to that I first came across through Austin Kleon's website. So you can visit Austin Kleon and click on Google, you'll find his website. He created this kind of thing, grid, I guess. I can't see the bars in this grid because I can't see in this PowerPoint presentation, but trust me, it's there. So we have mouths on the one side of this grid. We have eyebrows on the other side of the grid. And in the middle of the grid, we're going to draw eyes and a nose. So eyes and a nose are in each one. Now, what we're going to do now is we're going to express different types of emotions, combining this one and this one here, popping in there, combining this and this, popping in there, combining this one and this one, popping in there, and so forth. Now, have a look. I'm going to stay silent for a second. I'm going to reveal each one of them as we go through this process. And have a look how the expression on the face changes as we add these eyebrows and the mouth. quite amazing. We have a variety of different facial expressions just by using a simple variation in the mouth and with the eyebrows. So therefore, we can now draw something along these lines, right? I know, a little bit more complex, and you know, there's a lot going on here, but as you can see, you know, the eyebrows are still there, the mouth, you know, the mouth is expressive, and that is just a little bit more different, but they're not difficult to draw. You need to practice it a little few times, but these things are not difficult to draw. So it's all about just practice, just getting through it. And initially, when I was starting out, yeah, I would look at this and I would think, oh, that's too hard. But after a few times of practice, it's actually not too hard to express yourself. So I would encourage you to express your emotions, to, at the end of your day, just draw out all the different emotions you experience throughout the day. But I wanted to ask you, before we jump off this slide, what's the story here? Because they seem to be kind of eyeing each other, don't they? I mean, this could be very interesting. Let's see if we can see some connections, okay? All right, I see that this guy's feeling a little bit guilty because he might have told him something about him, and he's now frightened of him. And this guy's just, actually, I don't know what he's doing. They seem to be liking each other, and he's very happy, and these guys don't seem to impress. So, I mean, there's a lot going on here, like a soap opera drama. But I wanted to point out this guy. He's going to make a cameo appearance a little bit later on. So remember him, and as we move through another process down the track. So it's all about ideas, not artwork. And I just wanted to express that this is a person writing, correct? This is a person running as well, and so it is. This is a person running. Does it convey my ideas effectively? This is a person running. So if I'm going to convey the idea that a person is running, then this is all I need to draw. If I want to convey the idea that a female is running, I might maybe draw this, or I might just draw some hair on this person. So I don't need to go into this much detail. I don't need to do the shadow effects and anything like that, do the hair. If I want to express that a person's running, then a person's running. So it's about ideas, not artwork. And I guess that's the most important thing for us moving forward. So this is a standard form of note-taking. This is where we jump into note-taking and kind of IQ doodling and turning notes into IQ doodle. So this is an essay written by some kids and about how can adults explain climate change to kids. Now, this is something I just found on the web, and I just thought I'd share it because it's children, a kid writing about climate change. But when you look at these notes, think about all the visuals that we've kind of used as we move through this webinar. And when you look at these notes, what are you thinking? What are you thinking to yourself? How do you tend to feel viewing these notes? Are you kind of feeling, it's kind of maybe a little bit bored, confused, overwhelmed, frustrated? Is it a little bit different? If the notes were kind of more visual in nature, well, how can we improve these notes? Do you have any ideas of how we can improve these notes, given what we've discussed so far? Yeah, they're boring. Yeah, the notes are boring, and it kind of makes it difficult to sort of concentrate. If we're trying to learn this content, they can be quite boring. So in terms of what we can do in order to improve these notes, well, doodle the message. Yep, doodle the message. That's correct. We can doodle the message. Thanks, Tom. Okay, we can do this. We can add more color. Obviously, we can use icons, images, vary up the typography, create hierarchies, use bullets and headings, show relationships, separate ideas and themes. And these are all different things that we can do. And we're going to get into that right now, kind of progressing forward and show you how this actually can be done. No big picture, yes. Maybe mind map, exactly. Maybe mind mapped as well. I wanted to show this graphic over here, students. This is how students approach learning. Now, this is a very important visual. So they take notes along lines, they write in one color, they use long lists, and every page kind of looks the same. So this is they're thinking while they're actually studying, this is kind of boring, you know. And then while they're studying for exam, they think, this is so boring, again, now it's too hard, and that I can't do this, and then go, oh, what's that? Oh, let's do homework later. And they get preoccupied with the distractions of it. You know, and then TV is all about how to procrastinate. You've got games, you've got magazines, and all these different things. So what happens here in this situation? Look at what the distraction zone is filled with. It's filled with visuals. It's filled with visual images. Look at the magazines. They got pictures. They got graphics. The games, they got pictures, graphics, television, pictures, graphics. So no wonder the visual processing, our brains are hardwired to think, 75% of our brains are hardwired to think visually. So no wonder we are distracted. Students are distracted by visuals. So why? How can we put those visuals and add them and turn the notes into that kind of visual element? So express those notes in a visual way. And that's going to be the key, because maybe in the future, we won't get distracted by television, by games, by magazines, if our notes are more like these things here. So we need to turn our notes and make them more visual so that we can integrate these things. So we can encourage our brain to work through these activities, to work through our notes, to study for tests, for examinations and that. So let's turn IQ Doodle, let's turn notes into IQ Doodles. And here are the 10 different parts of an IQ Doodle that I would like to sort of present and discuss right now. So we've got, first of all, we've got typography. So when it comes to creating an IQ Doodle, it's important to focus on vary up your font. Remember the font study we discussed before? Well, vary up your fonts. Vary up your fonts when you're doing different things, and it will help you to remember and retain that information much more effectively. And then use doodles. So the standard forms of doodles, very simple images, pictures, and that. And again, I encourage you, as I go through this, pick up the pen, pencil, pick up your pen, and go through it. Then we've got the kind of handwriting. So if your pictures need more expression, more words to sort of describe what's going on, then do it, then include words, and don't shy away from words. Words are important. You've got to mix words with pictures, with visuals, with a lot of different elements. Then we've got separators. We can use separators to kind of separate different parts of the page, different parts of different information. Then we've got arrows that kind of interlink things together, point to things. And we've got bullets, and be creative with your bullets. So use different types of bullets for a variety of different things. Then we've got icons. So icons can express a whole lot of things. Now, this is an important point. This is a question mark. This is out of the box thinking maybe. All these icons can mean different things. You can have a lot of icons that you use to represent different ideas in your IQ Doodles. Then we have frames. So we use frames in order to kind of frame and kind of seclude ideas to each other. Then we have bubbles, speech bubbles that you can use to express thoughts. And we have connectors. So connectors, you can connect things out, if anything. You can connect it up and make things kind of intertwined together, so to lay down a path or something. So when it comes to IQ Doodles, I encourage you to use this as a reference sheet to say, okay, add these sort of elements in order to help improve my memory and recall of this information that I am learning and working through. So let's look at an IQ Doodle example. Now, I'll read through this. This is about goal setting, and then I'm going to show you how I create an IQ Doodle based on this short list of paragraphs. So goal setting encourages a sense of purpose and certainty. It encourages personal growth and responsibility. It encourages a positive outlook on life and also encourages prioritization of activities. To set goals effectively, you must follow the SMART approach for goal setting. Your goals must be specific, measurable, attainable, ready, and timed. To better understand this process, ask yourself the following questions. Do I know what I want? How will I know when my goal has been achieved? And do I believe I can attain this goal? Is this the right moment in my life to pursue this? And when will I complete this goal? So that's, in summary, the SMART goal setting process that you might like to follow if you're setting goals. So how do we IQ Doodle this? How do we take all the elements we had before, those 10 elements, and sort of piece them together and create an IQ Doodle? Well, we would first start with a heading. Say we've got goal setting as a heading. And from there, I would move on and create the rest of the IQ Doodle. And here is the result. There you go. So we've got the same information, that we used before, that was in the paragraph. And as a result, we have transferred that information into an IQ doodle. And this is more visually appealing. It helps stimulate the brain because it uses all the different types of elements except for color. I haven't used color. Personally, I just wanted to keep things simple for this presentation, just black and white, just to keep things as simple as possible. But you can use color as well. Color will help enhance different things. But now you might be asking, but Adam, I mean, if I wanted to learn that goal setting process, I mean, I could, you know, just read that paragraph over and over again, you know, eventually learn it, right? Yeah, you could. You could. And, you know, that might take you half an hour, that might take you 1 hour, whatever it is. But during that same time, you could create this graphic and your learning will be much more enjoyable. And you could use this as a poster that you could wall. And I guarantee you that when it comes to exhibition time, when it comes to doing anything, when you have to recall this information, you will remember far more information because you have visualized it. You have used your imagination. You have turned it into something that's yours, something from your imagination. So you will remember this information far more readily and for far longer, and it'll be much more enjoyable process having taken the time, the 20 minutes or so, the half an hour to actually put this together. And it doesn't need to be refined. It just needs to get that message across that you need to get across. And that's all that counts. So don't worry about the time you're going to spend doodling, because as you're doodling, as you're creating an IQ doodle, you're actually learning. You're learning throughout that process. And that's the most important thing. You're involving the imagination, and that means you're involving the right side of your brain. When you're involving the right side of your brain, you're also involving the whole brain. And the whole brain gets to learn this information, you're going to retain it much more effectively. So let's look at another example of an IQ doodle. This one is about facts about Earth, or facts, the different sort of things that happen on planet Earth. Now, I won't go through all these statistics, but you can just have a quick view of all the different statistics that are kind of put together about Earth. Earth is approximately 4.54 billion years old, etc. 97% of the water on Earth is salt water, 3% fresh. So, I mean, facts and stats like this are kind of difficult to learn, because you have to remember a lot of this information and it can get all very muddled up. So it's very simple process that if we can turn that into a visual that we can use for reference, it will help us to remember this information much more effectively. So let's have a look at what I've sort of put together in terms of putting these facts into a visual IQ doodle. Here we go. There you go. All those facts on the previous page, I spent some time. Yes, I spent a little bit of time putting this together. But now that I spent time putting it together, it's just, I can now remember, I can recall this information more effectively. I started off with the Earth in the middle, and from there I kind of, you know, 4.5, 4 billion years old, and I thought, oh, clouds go on top, and then we talked about lightning strikes, so let's put the clouds on top. Okay, temperature, really find a space for temperature, so let's sort of put it on the side here, kind of there. I had the Earth on the bottom. So any facts about the Earth, I just put them on the bottom. So I kind of categorized things sort of together. And then the water, I had the water on the side, and I kind of put all the statistics together. And then the air here with the bird flying and people being born. I was trying to think about how to represent a person being born. Well, how about us carrying a little baby? And as you can see, you can't even tell them that's really a baby, but it is actually a baby. Just two little circles inside, so it gets the idea across, and that's really what an IQ doodle is about. It gets the idea across, and that's what I want to encourage you to do. Get your ideas across in the most simple and effective way possible. I think that's the most important thing that we can do as we move forward through this visual thinking process. So let's go through mind mapping now. Now, I wanted to touch on mind mapping because that's really where I started. So it was all about mind mapping early on and kind of work through and university and everything like that. So let's get into mind mapping. This is a mind map I created about mind mapping. So about what the value is of mind mapping. And as you can see, I know I've shaded a few areas, but again, it's a simple, simple kind of shapes, using the visual alphabet to put these things together, just requires a little bit of imagination, a little bit of practice and that. So mind mapping is a brain-friendly diagram, it's a structured doodle, and I think the biggest thing I wanted to point out here is that mind mapping is one part of an IQ doodle, of visual thinking. It's not even a major part of visual thinking. It's just one small part. And mind mapping is great for some things, not so great for other things. But an IQ doodle gives you flexibility to do all sorts of things with your imagination, visual thinking, and that. So it is a structured form of doodle. It helps you brainstorm ideas, which mind mapping is great for. Help you stimulate imagination, sort information, remember things, facts, connect ideas, clarify thoughts, organize projects, essays, get improved focus, so all these different things. I have written up a blog post about mind mapping, how to mind map, that kind of goes into some of these areas. If you wanted to check that out, feel free to do so. A blog post, I actually have the following map. Another one written by Paul Foreman, drawn by Paul Foreman. This map here, this map is fantastic. I asked Paul to create that map for that particular blog post. And this map you can just use as a reference poster just to help you understand exactly what goes into every single mind map. So what goes into a mind map, this will help you to understand this. I'm not going to go through this map, but feel free to view it. On that previous blog post, you will find a copy of this mind map that you can download. So brilliant ideas from Paul Foreman, incredible way of structuring his maps. And if you would like to know how to draw maps in a creative way, then visit Paul Foreman's website. Fantastic. Just every single map is so different, and have a visit of website and you'll be amazed by his creativity. And the thing is that with some practice, anyone may be able to do that. It's just got to apply yourself and expand those areas. But then again, it's all about ideas, not artwork. So really focusing on that, ideas, not artwork. So let's look at a practical example of a mind map. I'll actually create a mind map, this text. So we're all familiar with the life of Alexander the Great, maybe some of us, maybe seeing the movie and that. So this is like something I pulled from Alexander the Great's life. So Alexander was the Greek king of Macedon. He was born in Palamis, 356 BC, and was tutored by Aristotle until the age of 16. By the age of 30, he had created one of the largest empires of ancient world, stretching from Greece to modern-day Pakistan. He was undefeated in about, I'm feeling exactly as this guy here. Remember him? Okay, exactly. I wasn't going to put you through the torture of reading absolutely everything on this page. This is a huge, chunky paragraph that's very difficult to remember, and you're probably feeling exactly like this guy here. So what we want to do is we want to turn this into a mind map. So how do we go about turning this into a mind map? Well, it might look something, actually, not something like that yet. How about this, okay? Does this give you a visual representation? Yeah, I mean, it's not a mind map, but it does give you a visual representation of where Alexander was, where his journey sort of took him. And I think that's important to have that sort of context. But we want something more. We want a mind map. So let's put a mind map together. And this is the mind map I came up with based on that large chunky paragraph that we had before. So I popped Alexander's face right in the middle of the map, and I separated the paragraph into four key branches. So four key branches, and I would encourage to, if you're going to create a mind map on A4 sheets of paper, probably no more than five key branches. Otherwise, the map just becomes a little bit too busy and too chunky. I'll try to keep it with that. But if you're using a bigger page, then by all means you can use a few more branches. But I think the most important thing when creating a mind map is you have to be able to, I guess, use your imagination to sort of try to pull ideas together. Or I guess not imagination so much. Just think about the content and consider how you can kind of put things together into clumps and chunks. So I separate the map in people into information about his horse, information about his campaigns, and information about his legacy. So, and then I expanded on all of these areas and drew pictures. And I wanted to highlight the dates because the dates are the important things that we really need to remember. And I drew some pictures as well just to sort of try to enhance that memory and recall of the information that we are learning. So So that's an example of a mind map that you can kind of put together. And I would highly encourage you to use mind maps. And it's been a valuable tool for me for a long time. And then I would encourage you to use visual thinking and IQ doodling as well and work on that process. So this is, let's go through an IQ matrix example. So this is an IQ matrix example, and I thought to share this one with you. It's a 360-degree thinking map. Now, this is, we talked about before about helping kids to develop hindsight, insight, and foresight. So these three things are keys to help them improve their decision-making and solve problems. And this is what this map sort of goes through. So I'll kind of go through a little bit of the map and just show you how to read it and what kind of elements it sort of explores. And I know some of you might be thinking, no, these are not my hands. As you can tell, let's see, they are not my hands. I actually purchased these hands for about $70 online at iStock Photo. Okay, that's yeah, expensive pair of hands. Okay, let's go through the map. Now, this is the first branch, hindsight. So we'll read, this is how I would read it. So hindsight, ability to critically examine past performance. Hindsight, ability to comprehensively understand situation events. Ability to extrapolate past knowledge experience to improve future decisions. Hindsight advantage helps you learn from mistakes, problems, failure, setbacks, experience, successes. And then we'll go down here. Hindsight, spend time reviewing your day. So this is how you develop hindsight, by asking yourself these types of questions. What did I do today? What decisions did I make? What actions did I take? What challenges did I face? How did I handle these challenges? How did I handle my emotions, etc., etc.? Then we've got the second branch. We've got foresight. So foresight, ability to predict future events, changes, trends, etc. Then we've got questions on this side. Now, when it comes to reading an IQ matrix, then I guess I wanted to touch upon the principle, the 80-20 principle. I'm not sure how many of you are familiar with 80-20 principle. Now, the 80-20 principle kind of goes into a lot of detail, saying that 20% of your actions will bring about 80% of your results. So I wanted to kind of put that into the context of this map. 20% of the most important things about this topic are in this map that will get you 80% of the results. So I haven't flooded this map with absolutely everything you need to know, absolutely everything about hindsight, insight, and foresight. What I've done is I've put different elements that are critical for learning about this topic. And as you move through the topic, it's not about reading this map. It's not about just reading, insight is catalyst for creativity, for innovation, for inspiration. Yeah, I want to read it. I want to read it and I want to think about this. This is a thinking map, so to speak. It's not about I'll read it and all of a sudden my life will change. I want to think about things. So I'm going to go through and I'm going to say, insight is catalyst for creativity. And I'm going to ask myself, okay, what does that mean to me? What does that really mean to me? And then how can I apply that into my life? If we go to the final branch, especially when it comes to the questions, so consistently ask insightful questions about yourself. Why do I do what I do? How is this of significance? And then I kind of think to myself, okay, when should I ask these questions to myself? When should I use these questions? When should I ask these questions of others? Okay, so here, insight requires being inquisitive. Okay, it's how can I be inquisitive? Okay, what does that mean to me to be inquisitive? Then insight requires being fully present. Okay, I need to be fully present. Okay, what does that mean? And by the way, I have many maps that kind of expand on these topics, that, for instance, a map about mindfulness. So if I want to go into more detail about being fully present, I might look at the mindfulness map, how to be mindful, and go into that map into more detail, and that will provide me with those extra details. And so there's a lot of different maps, and one about empathy as well, and all these different things. So there's a lot of different maps on the website. So that's this is a video I created about 360-degree thinking. It doesn't have any audio or anything like that. It just kind of presents things in a cool way with a hand, kind of showing words and pictures and that. So have a look at that video if you want on YouTube, or just look up the video on YouTube. Go to IQ Matrix YouTube page and have a look. It's right there, or even on the IQ Matrix main website. If you go to IQmatrix.com, and on the main website, there's a video tab right here, a video tab. You'll be able to check out the videos, all the videos that, not a lot of videos there, but there are a few videos you'll be able to check out and have a look at. And if you do visit IQ Matrix website, go to the free maps. There are 30 plus free self-growth maps for you to download. No registration, no nothing required. Just download them all in the format. So that's basically the overview of IQ Matrix. But now we reach that kind of the area that I really kind of, everything kind of comes together into one. And it's all about visual thinking and self-growth and how we can sort of apply that. And this is where the doodle and self-growth and visual thinking tools kind of come together and work as one, sort of like this. They come together and work as one. So I want to kind of bring these
atención,
together
la regulación
and combine them in order to help explore self-growth in a number of different ways. Remember storyboarding? We spoke about storyboarding before. So storyboarding is something that Walt Disney introduced, and they use it for movies, television commercials, and everything like that. Well, how about using storyboarding for solving problems? Now, all of these examples I'm going to give you are related to kind of kids and that, but they can be used for self-growth purposes as adults. You just need to change the topic that we're discussing, that we're talking through. So problem, okay, so the problem is, I would start off with discussing a problem with students, say dealing with bullies. So dealing with bullies, for instance, that's our problem. And now I would ask the kids, I would divide them into groups of four or five students, and I would give them five or six sheets of paper, and they would have to use those five or six sheets of paper to create a storyboard. Storyboard that takes them from the problem to a solution to that problem. And so the kids would work together, and I would tell them to just, you know, make it more interesting, that this is going to be the foundation of a 30-second television commercial, and going to be presenting a pitch for that commercial to TV executives, which is the rest of your class, down a little bit later on after you finished it. So make sure it's good. Make sure you think through this whole process. And this is what they might come up with. So there you go. You've got developing confidence. First of all, the most important point is to develop confidence, you know, participate in sport, have a lot of friends and learn. Then second step is to avoid bullies. Then if you're confronted by bullies, oops, okay, this is what you do when you're confronted by bullies. Be confident and strong, okay? Recruit supporters, and then speak with an adult to tell them about your experience. That brings about a kind of a problem to a solution kind of process that you can help work with kids and using storyboards as an example. And then you have them obviously presenting their storyboard to the rest of the class, so to see if the rest of the classmates actually agree or can help and give feedback and everything like that. So then they present it, and you open up the room for discussion, and you can even combine different storyboards to create one main storyboard down the line, which can help to really improve things. Okay, so now we've got the second one. This is one of my favorite activities that you can use in incorporating visual thinking tools. So this is called co-creation. Now, co-creation is a process where I would first begin by visualizing a problem on a whiteboard. So you would visualize a problem on a whiteboard, and this problem in this instance is improving concentration. So I would say, okay, improving concentration, and this is how to visualize it on the whiteboard. This is the problem that we have. I would then hand out a sheet of paper and a pencil or a pen to each student. Now each student would then, I'll give them, say, okay, think about this problem for about 2 minutes, okay, and I'm going to give you 30 seconds to jot something down. So after 2 minutes, give them 30 seconds, and they jot something down. They jot something down, 30 seconds, time's up. Okay, all right, bring your paper down to the front. Okay, let's all get into a circle. Now they get into a circle. Everyone gets into a circle. So this is what they have. They've jotted an idea down that helps them to solve the problem. Now, as they're in a circle, I ask them to pass the paper with their idea to the person on their right. So they pass the paper to the person on their right. And then that person has another 30 seconds to use whatever is on that page, in order to expand on that idea, to expand on the solution to that idea. Then again, after 30 seconds, pass it on to the next person, to the next, to the next, to the next. And then eventually it reaches, comes back to the same person who gets their original piece of paper. And it's just remarkable to see how much a problem can evolve from the beginning in an unexpected way coming back to the person. And the amount of great ideas that you can create through this process is profound. Later on, you can, of course, take all the sheets of paper, you can place them onto the wall, stick them up on the wall, and from there, every student gives every student about 10 minutes to kind of go to each sheet of paper and add further ideas, and then have a discussion, and then reach an overall sort of solution to this problem. So it really can help to expand creativity. And what we're doing here is all these IQ doodling techniques. We're using all these visual thinking things that we've been talking about so far to really, really get into this activity. And that's where want to encourage kids to solve problems. And wouldn't this be a much more effective way to solve a problem than trying to talk to a child about a solution or about an idea to a problem? This really helps to really extend and help them think in a variety of ways. So our third activity, we're going to go through, I don't think I mentioned six activities. So our third activity is Welcome to My World. So Welcome to My World is an activity more so about empathy, about understanding the other person. So we have, you divide kids up into two groups. And this can be something that adults can do. If you've got troubles in your relationship and you're kind of disagreeing about something, you've got kind of conflict or something, this is a fantastic activity to do. Now, what you would do is you would actually take out a sheet of paper and in absolute silence, both of these kids would actually doodle about a specific topic. So say, for instance, doodle the other person's, what you feel, how you feel the other person say learns, okay, how they do homework, how they study. And so they would spend, you know, a couple of minutes or 5 minutes or so doodling how they understand the other person's studies. And then after 5 minutes up, you would stop things and you would ask them to kind of mingle together and talk about the situation. Well, you know, that's good, but it's more like this. And oh, that's good, it's more like that. So this is a fantastic process to kind of get into the other person's head and into the other person's world to understand them. And fantastic tool for resolving conflict. Okay, if you have conflicts that you need to resolve, you kind of write down, okay, put myself into the other person's shoes. I'm going to now doodle how I believe the other person's feeling about this issue, and the other person does the same for me. And then we share our experiences together, and it really helps us to gather our thoughts about the issue. So fantastic for resolving conflict. And if you've got boys and girls together, you can even have them to explore each other's world, what it's like to be a boy, what it's like to be a girl, and working that way. So there's a lot of possibilities here in terms of working through this activity. This next topic, I call it the emotional voyage. Now, this kind of uses a little bit of a template. You don't have to make it as kind of detailed as this with the shading and everything like that, but this is a template about kind of exploring emotion, taking you from an emotion that you're currently experiencing to an emotion that you would like to experience. So this is a template filled out, say, by a little child, by a student. So how are you feeling? So in the cloud, it would write, I am feeling sad because Jerry made fun of me. And here, your ultimate goal is in the cloud of the island, okay? Your ultimate goal, how would you like to feel? So the boat needs to travel to the island, okay? There's storms in the way because this is how I'm feeling, but I want to travel to the island. So I want to get there, but I've got all these anchors weighing me down, and I've got holes in my boat, and this is me. This is me. This is how I'm feeling. So this is reasons why I feel this way. So I might put different reasons of why I'm feeling this way, or the child might put different reasons why they're feeling this way on sticky notes or just draw ideas there. And here, next to the shark, prolonged consequences of feeling this way. So what are the prolonged consequences of experiencing that, of feeling this way? Overall picture of, yes, okay, I feel this way. I want to feel this way. The reasons why I feel this way is because of such and such. And if I continue feeling this way, this is the result. Now, that gives us an overall picture of what that emotional sort of experience is for that child. And again, we can use this template as adults as well. So then we move to the next part of the template where we look at the solutions for that negative limiting emotion. we want to let go of the reasons that we're not feeling, not that reasons why we're feeling bad. And we want to sail, or we want to float to island of confidence, fly over there. So within the balloon, we would write all the ideas of how we can get from here to there. And I haven't put the ideas in here, but I hope you understand how this kind of process kind of works. And you would kind of get all these ideas together, and the child now has a path they can follow. They had a path about their emotion, they understand the emotion, and now they have a path that they can get from their emotional experience to the land of confidence, to the island of confidence. Okay, so let's move on. I know that some of you might have some questions in that, and I'm kind of moving through this. I hope that maybe at the end might have some time and I can help answer some of the questions. So if you could save some questions, and that would be a good thing, and I'll answer them at the end. Okay, and then our next one is a build a bridge. So our second last activity, visual thinking activity, is build a bridge. Now this is another template. I had another variation of this activity on my visual thinking magic website, which I'll give you a link to a little bit later on. But I kind of changed it and applied it to kids. So this is a reality. You're moving from a current reality that you're experiencing to a desired reality. So it's kind of like a more setting sort of activity. So first of all, on this side, you have a sad face. On this side, you have a happy face. So on this side, we would want to write out our current reality. So in terms of this student, I'm struggling in class. So he titles that reality, and then he creates an IQ doodle for this person. I'm frustrated. I have no idea what to do. You know, I'm running out of time. I'm overwhelmed. I can't organize. I can't get organized, etc. Okay, so that's their current reality. This is how they're experiencing. This is their world right now. And let's go and ask them to write down how they would like to feel, how they would like to experience their world. So this is, I'm doing well in class. So this is how they would like to feel. I can do this. I understand. This is fun. I'm organized. I have good ideas. Studying with friends. Okay. So this is their desired reality. So now they have a goal. Without really setting goal, without set a goal, they've actually set a goal. And this is the great thing about this process. And in order to get from the current reality to their desired reality, they must lay a path along this bridge. But before they get there, they have all these obstacles outside that can stand in the way, can distract them, following their self-belief, games, television can kind of, you know, prevent them from experiencing this reality. So as they lay down a four-step process to get to their goal, they need to look at ways that they can overcome these obstacles as well. So here we go, and this is the solution path forward, the four steps. Ask for help, friends, teachers, parents, ask more questions in class, get myself organized, schedule time for study. So there we go. We have a step-by-step plan for this child in order to get from their desired reality to from their current reality to their desired reality, a four-step process. And usually you probably don't need more than four steps, just to keep things nice and simple. So that's that process there, and fantastic to use as a goal setting activity. Oh, thanks, Melanie. See you later. Okay, so now the final activity is the bubble. The bubble is a comfort zone expansion sort of activity. Now, within the bubble is our world. It's my world. So you would instruct kids to draw their world within the actual bubble here. And within this world are all the things that they feel comfortable with. So this is our comfort zone, this is the bubble, and we feel comfortable. These are my books, these are my resources, these are my supporters, this is Barry, my dog, this is my computer, these are the skills. These are the skills that I have. I'm a fast reader, I'm good at sports, I'm great at puzzles. So these are all things I feel comfortable with, and kids can draw absolutely anything. The thing is, our goals, the goals that we want to achieve, are outside our comfort zone. And we cannot reach them because this is where they are. They're contained within other bubbles around here. So I want to be a race car driver. I want to be a good swimmer. I want to ace my exam. So to bridge the gap between here and there, it's not going to happen by staying in our comfort zone. We need to expand and grow our comfort zone. But it's the problem. The problem is that outside our comfort zone, we get very uncomfortable. And we can't go there because there's a lot of different things that happen. We'll go into that shortly. First of all, just around just the comfort zone is a very small sort of zone, very small zone. that is called a comfortable learning experiences zone. Okay, kind of long word, long name, but you get the idea. It's kind of the zone where we kind of learn things, but we don't really need to step outside our comfort zone too much to learn these new things. So, for instance, I want to become a good swimmer, but, okay, so I'll just read the water safety manual. I mean, that gives me an idea that I'm kind of making progress in that direction, but really I'm not really making too much progress because I'm still pretty comfortable. So outside the comfort zone is the panic zone, okay? The panic zone, the fearful zone, these are where all the fears, obstacles, and problems lie. So these are all the things that are preventing us from moving forward. And if we want to achieve this goal, if we want to achieve this goal, we have to break through these areas. So I'm afraid of drowning, you know, I'm afraid of water. But what we don't realize, and this is the great thing about moving into new territories, is that when we approach a new problem, when we have experienced, you know, overcome an obstacle, when we overcome a fear, there are opportunities. There are people, opportunities, there are great things attached to those problems, but we just don't see them. So for instance, a fear of water, I have a fear of water, but if I overcome that fear, I'll be able to save my own life. If I get into trouble in water, I'll be able to save other people's lives as well if I get into trouble in water. So there's always opportunities, and we must look at those opportunities when we expand and grow our comfort zone. And I think that's probably the most important thing when using this template. But as you can see, it really helps kids visualize exactly how they need to kind of stretch, how they need, what they need to break through, where they need to go in their world, from their world expanding. Because I think we don't prepare kids enough for the real world to understand these sort of processes. And they're robbed from their dreams, from their desires, by all these fears, all these problems or imaginary problems that they see before them. And we need to help them to break through that area. We too need to be able to break through those areas. And using these templates such as this can really help us from that regard. And here is a great video. This video is very similar to the ideas that I sort of spoke about there. And it's called Do You Dare to Dream? It visualizes the comfort zone and everything perfectly. I mean, this is a video that I think every kid should see. Every kid, whether you're 10 years old or whether you're 50 years old or 70 years old, every kid, you know, should see this. So, I mean, if you've got a child sort of mindset, then please watch this, and you love the doodles, you love everything that this message is getting across. Fantastic. Please have a view of that video, 100%. And I guess this kind of brings me towards the ending now, and I'd like to thank all these people for the inspiration they've given me along this journey from mindset to visual thinking and everything like that. Have a look at these people on the web. Okay, type in their names, and you have their links here to their websites in their PowerPoint presentation. I mean, Tony Buzan, mind mapper, Paul Foreman, mind mapper, Sonny Brown, visual thinker, Dave Gray, Christina Merkley. Okay, you've got Dan Rohn, Eva Lotto Lamb, Mike Rohn, Michael McCalco. I mean, a lot of the concepts and ideas that I've presented to you today has been a intermingle of all these ideas from these great minds, great thinkers, and that. And then I added some of my own elements to that as well. So it's, please visit. If you're interested in visual thinking, visit these people's websites and explore their books. They got books, they got a website, blog posts, and everything like that. They've got workshops. And I know Tony Buzan's in England, Paul Foreman's in England, some of the others are scattered around the world, and that, Canada, USA, and that. So I also wanted to thank Thomas Edison, Leonardo da Vinci, Charles Darwin, Isaac Newton, and others for laying the foundations for visual thinking and that. So thank you. Thank you so much. And I wanted to, just before we finish up, I wanted to have this dream, so to speak, and I want to ask you if you're dreaming about maybe the same sort of thing. I want to kind of, my dream is to kind of evolutionize the education process for visual thinking, self-growth, and the doodle. And to empower kids through this process, I think that's the most important thing. And the way I'm going to be going about it is through specialized workshops for kids, implementing some of these ideas and things that we discussed today. And also wanted to launch I'm planning to launch an online platform that explores these areas in much more detail. So this will be an online global learning platform. The structure of it is, I'm not sure yet exactly, but it will be thereabouts, something, a mix of visualthinkingmagic.com. This was a website that I started up a few years back. It was kind of like an experimental sort of website about visual thinking. And this here is BizWiz, and he was the star of the website. You're seeing him on just about every page. You see him on every page of that website. So I might bring him along to the new website as well. We'll see how we go. Ultimately, I'd like to start a visual thinking school, maybe over like a holiday program, school holiday program, just to kind of give kids the necessary insights they need in order to be able to think visually and explore visual ideas much more effectively. So that's, I guess, the sort of ultimate goal. And here's what you can do. Here's what you can do. This is the last slide. I promise you, it's the last slide. Okay, so this is what you can do. You can begin visually applying all these different tools and everything that we've discussed so far. Begin thinking visually. Help others to think visually. So help them to understand these concepts as well. Show them how powerful this whole process can potentially be. And then introduce kids to visual thinking. Yeah, introduce them to visual thinking. I know that kind of looks like a cauliflower, but trust me, it's a brain. It's an iron brain, visual thinking. Yeah. Again, you could label it, just if you're confused, just label anything underneath, just to let them know what it is. And send me your ideas and experiences. Send me ideas and experiences. AdamSicinski@gmail.com. That's my personal email account. I have another one, info@ikimetrics.com. But if you're going about visual thinking, then feel free to send it to AdamSicinski@gmail.com. And also, stay updated. Okay, Twitter, AdamSicinski. That's my main Twitter that I'll use for visual thinking. And also on the Visual Thinking Magic website, there's a Facebook page on the side where you'll see access to a Facebook page. And I'll update when the new website's released through that Facebook page. So we'll kind of integrate concepts across. So will you join me? You know, will you join me in capacity in order to share these ideas with others and to help kids and help yourself, to help the world around you? And let's build a better world together. Let's do it. Let's be better visual thinkers, and let's help change and transform the education process and build upon the foundations of what some great minds have already put together for us. So that's it for me. I want to thank everyone for coming in and for watching this presentation, for listening. It's been a pleasure to speak with you today. And I know some of you in some parts of the world, it's very late, and I appreciate the fact that you stayed up so late in Australia. And I'm in Melbourne, Australia. It's morning. It's like just after 10:30 now. So
I'm here, Adam.
So thank you very much. Thank you. And
I loved everything you said, every word that came out of your mouth. And I think I'm not the only one.
Questions.
Very much appreciated. And the work you've put into this and what you're doing and the fact that you do want to make a difference. And visual is the key, you know, except for people who are impaired. So it's really, really important. To get mindfulness, and it doesn't matter whether it's through the visual alphabet or whether it's through any other kind of meditation, it certainly is the way to go. It kind of reminded me of a yoga course that I once took, doing yoga in the classroom, and it also involved a lot, even though it was yoga in the classroom where you don't need mats or anything, but it did involve lots of doodling and lots of circles and, you know, the perpetual circle and going around and writing and doing, you know, various things to focus, because that's the idea. It's to be and to live the moment instead of, you know, living the past or stressing over the future. So it's really been amazing. It's a great way to end the last session of the Spring Blog Festival. A lot to reflect on, Adam, and blog about. And that's what the participants are going to be doing. They're going to be reflecting and blogging. And if they can add some mind maps and some doodling in the process, and today it's so easy to do it and share with the iPad or with a digital camera or with an iPhone or Android or whatever your smartphone, whatever you happen to have. It's been incredible. I'm sorry that it's ending, tell you the truth, even though I've been up for 10 hours for 3 days on these sessions. It's been absolutely brilliant. So thank you so much, Adam. I'd love to be part of the revolution. I've been asking for a revolution in school since since high school, since I was in high school. That's when I rebelled. I actually quit school, even though I'm a doctor. I went back to school, but I quit school. I quit high school. I left because I couldn't take it anymore. And then I came back. But it's really time to do something. And you're in Melbourne, Australia. You know, we're all over. So let's do it. You know, stay connected and let's do it. Adam, thank you.
Nellie, thank you for organizing this event, and I appreciate all the help you've given me throughout this process. And you've worked really hard, and I hope that it's
thank you,
it's
Adam.
Really
and we'd like you to continue
to
stay connected,
all the different,
where it's
different
not going to disappear, that's the
thank you very much.
The
thank
area.
You.
I don't know if
greatly
you've been there,
it.
Adam. The link is there. Tom has added it, and we are a kind of community. It's, you know, people who care, you know, mostly educators, but others who are going into the education field who care and want to make a difference. So join us and let's continue this. So there's a link and have a wonderful day and realize that, Adam, you have touched all of us.
Let's do it. Okay, fantastic. Fantastic.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. Copy
thank
the
you.
Chat.
Thank you, Nellie.
Yes.
Thank you, everyone. For
Adam,
coming.
That was
greatly
one of the,
appreciate
you can
it.
Get the comments if you copy the chat. Usually Tom does it, but it's a great idea. There's copy chat. Can you see that? Yeah, you copy it. Yeah, and then you can take, you know, some of the comments. There was a suggestion, some people wanted, I forget
chat.
Who
okay,
it was,
cool.
Someone sent
I'll
me a private message
yeah,
there, asking if you could doodle us. I don't know if, you know, it's something that, you know, the participants. But I think we can doodle ourselves after learning the visual alphabet.
Yeah, of course. It's
exactly.
I guess
and
my
Adam, I wanted to ask you. I just remember. Would you
very
consider
accurate, but it's
giving
the idea,
a course
right? It's
on
the idea
this?
That matters.
Because there's
so,
a lot of information
artwork,
here, and you went through it very quickly because we didn't have enough time. But I think that a course on this for teachers could start a ripple effect. And it would get a lot of teachers from all over the world. So can we talk about that? Maybe
can.
Tomorrow after I get some sleep.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think we can.
Okay.
We can definitely work something.
Yeah. So everybody, let's try and see if we can get Adam to give a course on Wiz IQ.
Absolutely.
This
let's
way,
do it.
So
let's
we
do it.
Can
let's
learn
connect
together.
On some.
Thank you.
Awesome.
Have a wonderful week and the rest of the Sunday. For you, it's Monday, isn't it, Adam? It's Monday. Wow. Wow. Okay. All right. So have a great week. Thank you, everybody. Bye. Thank you for joining us. And
it's Monday already.
Let's stay in touch. Bye-bye.